My name's Timothy West, and this is my wife, Prunella Scales.
We are a pair of actors of a certain vintage.
Basil?
All the world's a stage, and in our time we both played many parts, but as we head towards the final curtain call, there are still a couple of parts we'd like returning to.
The captain.
Cast off, please.
Aye, sir.
And his mate. Prue's memory is not what it was.
Oh, my darling, I'm so sorry. I didn't cast you off.
It's true. Some days I don't know whether it's Monday or Lewisham, you know.
But exploring canals and waterways is something we can still share.
Something we both love.
And together, we've travelled up and down Great Britain and across the world.
So now it's time to head for waterways anew. This time, Bella Italia.
El Borghetto va!
We'll cross Italy's largest lake.
Magic.
Exploring exotic islands.
Garden of Love. Well, we've got to go there, Tim.
And plush resorts.
Cheers.
Before navigating Europe's oldest working canal.
You can almost feel you're in the background of a great Renaissance painting.
Into the heart of a modern city.
I never imagined arriving in Milan by canal.
It's the fashion capital of Europe.
I'm a dream lady.
You're a dream lady.
But this is more than just another voyage.
We've got a mission, almost a pilgrimage.
This canal was built for the glory of God.
Magnifico.
Yeah. It's almost eternal.
Framed by the Alps, the Swiss and Italian lakes, renowned for their beauty, are a famous playground of the super rich. But in centuries past, they were vital trade routes, linking the great cities of medieval and Renaissance Europe. None was more important than the route that ran through Lake Maggiore, along the Naviglio Grande Canal, to the historic center of Milan. Our voyage along this ancient waterway begins in Switzerland. At the top of Maggiore lies the lakeside town of Locarno.
Before we set off, we're paying a visit to a sacred place to which pilgrims have travelled for centuries.
Magnifico!
Yes, it is, isn't it? In the 15th century, the Virgin Mary appeared here in front of a lucky Franciscan friar, right here.
Bang center stage.
Yeah, of course.
And so he built this church in her honor.
Our Lady of the Rock.
As we are about to embark on another perilous journey, I hope that Our Lady of the Rock will give us her blessing.
That's where we're heading, south into Italy. Distance of about 80 miles.
Quite a voyage.
Yeah.
Okay. It certainly is. Beginning our voyage in Switzerland, we'll cross the border into Italy to explore the beautiful and exotic Borromean Islands. Heading further south, we'll trade our motor cruiser for an Italian-style narrowboat, passing humble villages and grand palazzos. We'll navigate into the historic heart of Milan. We've headed down to Locarno's quayside to pick up our boat.
Quite swish around here.
Yes.
The boat hire in this particular lake is rather tricky. It's either a millionaire's gin palace or something quite a bit smaller.
Is that us over there?
Yeah.
Timmy, it's a speedboat.
Yeah, it's quite small, but nippy. 350 horsepower.
What happened to life at 4 miles an hour?
I think they call it a midlife crisis.
You don't need me on this. You need a couple of blondes in bikinis.
No, they weren't available. They were booked for a summer show.
Oh, charming. Very smart.
That's nice, isn't it?
Not bad. Just room to mix a martini.
or a Negroni. Good.
There's one fundamental difference between this vessel and my narrow boat back home.
Eccolo. Libera la barca. Grazie.
Speed.
Oh! Oh! Piano, piano!
Yeah, sorry.
Oh, really?
Yes, just taking a little time to get used to the throttle.
I first visited the lakes with my family 70 years ago on our first holiday abroad. It felt impossibly glamorous. This was where stars of the silver screen holidayed. Audrey Hepburn, Laurence Olivier and Vivian Leigh. And now I'm back with Timothy West.
Where are we heading, Skipper?
Well, our first stop is a quarry. They've been quarrying stone there for over 600 years, just to build one building, the Duomo in Milan.
Well, that's a lot of stone for one building.
Yes, and not just any ordinary stone either. It's a special kind of marble. We'll be following the marble route all the way to Milan.
One of the reasons we wanted to navigate this waterway was because, unlike the coal-carrying canals that we're used to, its primary purpose was never industrial, but sacred.
To the greater glory of God.
In the 14th century, the Milanese decided to build a cathedral larger and more magnificent than any that the world had seen before. They elected to use a rare and beautiful pink marble from the Candolia Quarry, here on the lakeside.
We are in one of the oldest quarries in Candolia.
The happily named Francesco Canali is the latest in a long line of chief engineers of the Duomo.
When they decided to build the Duomo 600 years ago, they knew about this place.
Since it was known since Roman times, but it was very difficult to quarry it.
The cathedral's design was so ambitious that it took 6 centuries to complete. And marble is still needed to restore it today.
Here we are. Consider the beauty of the Candolia marble. Yeah.
It's just beautiful, isn't it?
Magnificent. Yeah.
How much marble a year do you have to deliver?
It depends on the year, but average 300 cubic meters.
Quite a lot of marble for a cathedral that's already built.
Yeah, you're right.
Today, the marble goes to Milan by road, but originally it was taken by water.
From this mountain, you can see all the lakes and the rivers on which boats brought the marble from here to Milan.
Look at that, Tim.
400 people were employed for maintenance of these canals, the same amount of people that was employed for the construction of the cathedral.
Without that network of waterways, the building of the Duomo would not have been possible. The barges, with their precious cargo, traveled to the southern end of the lake and then transferred, for the final leg of their voyage, onto Europe's oldest canal, the Naviglio Grande.
So, for how long was the canal used for transportation of the marble?
Actually, until the Second World War, so for nearly 550 years, for such a long time.
So, we are making the same journey as was made 500 years ago.
Definitely.
And to bring us closer to the Italian bargees of old, Director Canali is providing us with the authentic cargo.
Could you bring this piece of marble to Milan for me?
Right you are, we've got a mission. Almost a pilgrimage.
Waterways don't just carry cargoes of coal and stone. They transport people and ideas too.
We're not far from the Italian border now, but before we cross it, I thought we'd stop off at Ascona. Back in the beginning of the 20th century, this was a place for free thinkers, vegans, nudists. Sort of led the way to the hippie movement.
If you can remember the 60s, you weren't there, man.
But the first summer of love wasn't in 1960s California, but in 1900 Switzerland. On the shores of this lake, at a place called Monte Verita.
Magic place, isn't
it? Yeah. If I wanted to adopt the natural life, I can think of worse places to start, can't I?
Yes.
To tell us more about Europe's first hippie commune.
Hello.
Hello.
We're meeting guide Charlotte Simona.
Welcome to the Mountain of Truth.
Monte Verita.
Monte Verita.
Why is it the Mountain of Truth?
It's called the Mountain of Truth because the founders that arrived here wanted to live an existence which entailed truth and freedom of life back to nature. Mm. They wanted to reform everything, the way they would write, the way they would think, the way they would be dressed. Or not dressed, indeed, yes.
They followed a strict regime of exercise, regular sunbathing, and cold baths in the outdoors. All done wearing as little as possible. Whilst nudism is yet to go mainstream, other ideas developed at Monte Verita are being taken up today.
They actually call themselves vegetabilists. They not only banned meat, but also any animal products like milk, eggs, and butter.
That's a very strict form of vegetarianism.
Oh, absolutely. They were the early vegans.
Oh, right, yes.
The embrace of a natural way of life extended to their dwellings.
This would have been one of our typical light and air huts. We had 14 of these around the complex. They would live in a very, very simple lifestyle. Ida Hoffmann, one of the founders, was of the idea that the only thing that the human should contemplate was the beautiful view outside of the window.
It seems lovely in decent weather. What was it like in the winter, in the cold?
Well, I could imagine it would have been probably pretty cold. But then they were extreme naturalists. They would have enjoyed the snow, the environment.
Yeah, yeah.
It gave them inspiration.
One man who found his inspiration here changed modern dance forever.
In 1913, we had here the Hungarian choreographer and dancer, Rudolf von Laban. He started a summer school here at Monte Verita.
Rudolf Laban used the connection between natural shapes and movement to train dancers. Actors used his techniques too, including a lady called Prunella Scales.
Does this remind you of anything?
Well, yes, I suppose movement classes at drama school.
Would you like to come inside?
Right.
We are inside this crystal.
This is amazing.
Yes. Laban say, every man is a dancer.
Every man is a dancer, yes indeed.
Except possibly Timothy West.
You're fine, as long as you have the practice.
How strange to think ideas that influenced me throughout my career came from this very mountain.
So, up. Up into the sky, down
into the earth, and then we close into our side, and we open into the other side.
Out and inward.
With her condition, she's lost so much. But sometimes I do get a glimpse of my old Prue.
And then we move into the future.
No future.
And it's wonderful.
Bravo.
Bravissima.
The free thinkers of Monte Verità came here to escape from the world, to be close to nature. And being back here myself reminds me of how I felt when visiting these lakes as a young woman. I reveled in the freedom and the sheer beauty of this place.
Here we go.
Grazie tanto.
So it's wonderful to be back, 7 decades later, with the man I love.
Glass of wine.
Some local cheese.
Oh, eccellente.
Each other?
Cheers. Yeah.
We're on a voyage from the Alps to Milan, following an ancient trade route via lake and canal.
It is a pretty special lake, isn't it?
Yeah. John Ruskin called it the Eden of Italy. Purest air, richest earth, loveliest wave.
Very nice.
Crossing Lake Maggiore, we've left the snow-capped mountains of Switzerland behind and headed into Italy, bound for the famous Borromean Islands and a fashionable lakeside resort.
In centuries past, battles were fought for the right to rule this lake, and the victors were the Borromean princes, whose watery realm we are now entering.
The Borromean family were North Italy's answer to the Medicis. They owned a bank in Milan and controlled the trade on this lake for centuries.
That sounds like good business.
Certainly was.
Taxing the trade to and from Milan enabled the Borromeans to accrue vast wealth, which they liked to put on display on the islands they owned.
Over there is Isola Madre, and this is the Isola Bella.
Beautiful island.
Yeah. With the most beautiful Baroque garden in the world,
of
apparently.
Yes, yes. I want to wander around there.
Yeah.
The garden was created by Carlo Borromeo III to show off his wealth and power, but also as an expression of his deep love.
It's extraordinary, isn't it?
Our guide is Emanuela Ciolina.
Nada is his gold Bella, but in the past it was called Isola Isabella because he dedicated the island to his wife.
But Isola Isabella.
That's very romantic.
Would you buy an island for me and call it Isola Prunella?
Of course.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
The palace was conceived just like a place of retreat, a paradise away from the world. The Borromeos still use this palace as their summer residence today.
Good Lord.
This is the amphitheater. It was used as a backdrop for plays.
What a wonderful piece of set design, isn't it?
Yes.
Quite difficult not to be upstaged by the scenery, though.
Oh, look!
Yes, and could get a bit rowdy in the cheap seats.
Most beautiful gardens I've ever seen.
Yeah.
This is the Azalea Terrace, and you're quite lucky you've come here in the right month to admire
yes.
the blooming.
Azaleas native to the area?
No, naturally. Plant hunters traveled all around the world
yeah.
and they imported here azaleas, camellias, also rhododendrons. They find here the ideal climate, the
yes.
ideal acid soil.
Yes.
That's
yes.
why the azaleas are known as the flowers of the lake.
It's a climb of over 120 feet to the top of the island.
They're quite steep, these steps.
But it's worth the effort.
Magic.
Look at the
Absolute
view. That's
magic.
Really wonderful.
The Borromeans shaped this island to resemble a galleon, rising from the waters of the lake. We are now walking on its rear deck.
So what about down there, those extraordinary hedges?
This is the Garden of Love.
Garden of Love? Well, we've got to go there, Tim.
Oh, gosh.
With its ornate topiary, hanging terraces and statues, the Garden of Love was designed in typical Renaissance style.
And here behind you, the statue of Cupid.
Peacock's feather, a present from the Garden of Love.
Thank you, my darling.
By the 18th century, these gardens had become famous throughout Europe. A must-see destination on the Grand Tour. And in 1797, the Emperor of France took time out from his battle campaigns for a weekend break with his wife on Isola Bella.
So Napoleon brought Josephine here. Mm-hmm. The Garden of Love. How romantic.
Well, yes, romantic up to a point, but don't forget that Napoleon divorced Josephine after 5 years. We've been married over 50.
And you've never said, not tonight, Prunella.
Right, our next stop is where the ordinary folk live. We're going to one of the islands that's not owned by the Borromeans. Isola Pescatori.
Fisherman's Island.
Fisherman's Island, that's
great.
Right. They've been providing fish for the Borromean princes and princesses for centuries. And hopefully for us, for lunch.
Oh, good.
There have always been fishermen on Isola dei Pescatori. And at one time, fishing on the lake supported 140 families. But times have changed, and today there is only one man still fishing.
We're meeting Stefano Ruffoni, the last fisherman on Fisherman's Island, and to help with translation, his friend Giulio Torelli.
So for how long have you been fishing here?
40.
40.
When you were tiny.
When you were
little. Yeah, of course, yeah.
Andiamo a pescare?
Go fishing?
Okay. Yes.
Lovely.
We've been promised lunch at Stefano's family restaurant, but we have to catch it first.
Stefano, how long have your family been fishing here?
Si pesca da sempre. Tutta la mia famiglia ha sempre pescato. Mio nonno. Speriamo nei miei figli.
Well, his family have been doing it for generations, and they will for many generations to come.
It seems Prue's doing her own translations.
That's good to hear, Stefano. Good luck.
Questa è la vita del pescatore. La vita più bella.
So, when did you lay that net? When did you drop it?
Ieri sera. Prima che faceva scuro, siamo andati a metterle.
He put out his nets in a thunderstorm.
Yeah.
Coraggiosa, coraggiosa.
Coraggiosa.
Despite her condition, Prue still speaks fluent French, but also Italian, apparently.
Parla bene l'italiano.
Grazie tanto. Ho fatto un anno nella scuola. Qualche anni fa.
Qualche anni fa.
What about the Italian boyfriend?
Oh, my.
In the season, Stefano goes fishing every day for bream and trout.
Yeah. All right.
Although I'm not sure he has need of an apprentice.
How are you doing?
I'm not good at doing this.
But despite my lack of ability, lunch is still being reeled in.
That was a big one.
Oh, big one, yeah. Okay.
Give me a knife and fork, and I have no problem.
Oh, it makes me want to be vegetarian.
It gives me an appetite for lunch.
With tourists still flocking to this picturesque island, there is still a good living to be made in the restaurant trade.
Hi, Stefano.
But nothing tastes quite like your own catch.
Good?
Mm, yeah.
I caught it.
Well done.
Well, I helped.
Sante, il pescatore.
Si.
Over the years, the Gulf of Borromeo has had many celebrated visitors. And there is one in whom I'm particularly interested, the American author Ernest Hemingway, who in 1918 stayed in the mainland resort of Stresa.
Here we are, Grand Hotel, 1863, Belle Epoque.
Cute.
Yeah, isn't it?
A Red Cross volunteer in the First World War, Hemingway was badly injured on the Italian front. He came to Grand Hotel des Îles Borromées to convalesce. And it was here that he set his most famous novel, A Farewell to Arms, a romanticized version of his own experience in the war.
Buonasera.
Buonasera, Mrs. Corella.
Hello.
Mr. Timothy West, welcome to Stresa. Welcome.
Manager Gianluigi Mariani knows how important the writer's relationship was with this hotel.
Hemingway used to sit at the bar and having a drink. That's something he shared with the characters of his book,
you know.
He was used to drink a dry martini with almonds, salted almonds.
That was what he always drank.
That's what he always drank. And we have a cocktail on our list called Hemingway Special, and we serve it with salted almonds.
Well, it's 5 to 6, so it's nearly time for a drink.
Nearly.
After writing A Farewell to Arms, Hemingway returned to this hotel in 1948.
Now we go to the Hemingway suite on the first floor.
By then, he was a much richer man.
Please.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Aha. The books obviously sold well.
I think it did all right.
Yes, it did all right.
A night in the suite today will cost you 3,630 euros. But that does include breakfast.
Hemingway could afford this only after he wrote Farewell to Arms. Then he was a wealthy man. When he was recovering from the wounds of war,
yes. He
was just a poor sergeant.
Do you think we'll ever hit that bracket to be able to afford to stay here and entertain?
I don't think so. We've still got the payment on the dishwasher.
This is our book with the signature of the most important guests we ever had. Here we have somebody you know, Mussolini.
Oh, yeah.
And here we have Steinbeck, many other people.
A hero of mine.
Toscanini, yeah.
Yes.
And here we have Mr. Hemingway himself, see? He's signing 1st October 48.
Yes.
Ernst Hemingway, an old client.
Yes.
And here we have a blank page. And you sign.
Quite an honor.
Oh, so you're part of the history of the Borromese now.
Yeah,
brilliant.
Very humbled, yeah.
Hemingway might not be a fashionable writer anymore, but he certainly knew how to pick a good bar.
And I sat in a high stool, ate salted almonds, potato chips, drank a couple more martinis, and did not think at all. I had never tasted anything so cool and clean. They made me feel civilized. The war was a long way away. Maybe there wasn't any war. There's no war here. Then I realized it was over for me.
Oh, well.
We're on a voyage from the edge of the Swiss Alps to Milan. Having reached the southern end of Lake Maggiore, it's time to switch to a more familiar type of waterway.
Well, Canal. Is this where we pick up our narrowboat?
Oh, well, they do things rather differently in Italy. It's not a narrowboat, it's a barquette.
sort of cross between a barge and a gondola. Come on.
Ecco.
Once the workhorse of a vast network of northern canals, the 17th century barquette carried cargo and passengers.
You want to come on board?
Sadly, skipper Giuseppe Cerani and his crew run the only one left on the Naviglia Grande Canal.
So we're lucky that, along with guide Andrea Gambadoro, they have agreed to take us all the way to the city.
So there were many such boats at one time with her.
Quindi c'erano molte di queste barche.
Ogni paese aveva due o tre barche corriera che facevano servizio passeggeri a Milano.
And on the way to Milan it was about 6 hours.
Viaggiavano uno vicino all'altro.
It was fun.
Yeah.
We're navigating our way along the oldest canal in Europe, following the same route that marble-carrying barges first took 6 centuries ago. And we're taking our own precious fragment of this marble to the heart of the city and the Duomo.
You all right, Prue? Enjoying yourself?
Yes, very happy, thank you.
A bit more like home, isn't it?
Yeah.
Back in the early Renaissance, roads in northern Italy were muddy and dangerous, plagued by wolves and even bears. Built between 1177 and 1257, Europe's first canal network, the Navigli, offered a safer and quicker alternative. With locks designed by Leonardo da Vinci, they linked Milan to the sea, transforming the city into a large and prosperous inland port.
Adesso vuoi provare a guidare un po' te?
Do you want to have a try?
C'è il comando.
Grazie.
Abbiamo un navigatore più che esperto, sicuramente più esperto di me.
The engine is so beautifully silent, isn't it? Wonderful.
The original canal boats were towed by teams of horses who, when travelling upstream, had to pull hard against the strong current. But heading downstream to Milan, boats simply drifted, while the horse enjoyed a nice ride in the bow.
It's beautiful, isn't it?
Yes, it is. I've always loved Italian art, culture, music, but here you can almost feel you're in the background of a great Renaissance painting. Where are we heading?
Qui stiamo arrivando a Boffalora.
Oh, Boffalora,
In questo villaggio. Sì. Nel 1700 c'era la stazione di posta per il cambio del cavallo. Il barchetto va!
Il barchetto va!
Traveling by barchette had the added benefit of in-boat entertainment.
Musici.
Oh, good.
Music, storytelling, and even a raffle were all part of the service. Filippo Ranzani and Nicoletta Maure are singing us a traditional song about a boat exactly like this one, the Barchette of Boffalora.
Is a man saying, if you love me, I'll promise you that we'll go around this beautiful cruise. And I got already the ticket. I actually got already the luggage. Come on board. There is wine.
Oh, darling, why didn't you say this earlier?
Yeah, I know. Sul barchetto di Boffalora,
so how long did it take to get to Milan?
About 6 hours.
But with wine, song and good company, who's counting? Yeah.
The canal created a 15th century transport revolution. It became fashionable with the Milanese elite, and elaborate villas began to pop up along its banks.
Giuseppe.
Oi.
Dove siamo?
Siamo quasi arrivati a Robecco, a Villa Gaia.
Villa Gaia? Oh, Villa Gay.
Yes, but in the sense that it was jolly and great fun. In Renaissance times, it was the place to be. It really was.
The cream of society once came from far and wide to attend Villa Gaia's fabulous parties. Today, we're welcomed by local guide Chiara Del Miglio.
Isn't it beautiful?
It is gorgeous. So there were big parties here?
Big parties, a lot of food, a lot of beautiful Italian women, and there was some small rooms that were used for intimate relationships.
How intimate?
Yeah, I don't know how intimate.
We've come 500 years too late, my darling.
One of the most regular guests here was the Duke of Milan. The legend says that he really loved eating a lot, and he became so fat that he wasn't able to ride a horse. So he reached Robecco, Milan, using boats, and he forced people to create a small canal for him.
Could hold things up a bit if you had to build a canal before you went anywhere.
Yes, you'd have to plan ahead, wouldn't you?
Yes, a bit.
The ballroom is still used for weddings, summer parties, fun. But upstairs lie the old private rooms, seemingly untouched by the passing of the centuries. The corridors echo with the secrets of the past.
There is a story about the secret love between a beautiful countess, Countess Casati, and her private servant.
The servant was fatally wounded in a terrible accident, but with his final breath, he promised her that his love for her was stronger than death.
According to the locals, every midnight, a beautiful knight arrives riding a horse, preceded by a flame, and stands here waiting for his beloved. Every sunrise, the flame disappears, and the knight vanishes into the canal.
And a sad story.
Oh, he still loved her, mm-hmm. Even after he was dead.
Yes.
Oh.
And let's not hang around to see if he comes back tonight.
Allora, andiamo a Milano.
We're on a voyage from Lake Maggiore to Milan's magnificent cathedral, following a centuries-old route taken by vessels carrying the precious marble used to build it.
You enjoying yourself on Europe's oldest canal?
Well, it's magical.
For over 50 years, the city turned its back on its canals, but gradually, the Milanese are rediscovering them.
Canoeists said.
Shall we wave?
Nice to see any boat on this canal, isn't it?
Yes, indeed.
Even a canoe. That's Cristoforo. When we get the other side of that church, we're in Milan itself.
I never imagined arriving in Milan by canal. It's got rather pretty now, hasn't it?
Yeah. This is called the Navigli district.
Yes.
Once lined with warehouses full of goods coming to and from Milan.
Lovely balconies. Oh, I'd love to live up there.
These banks once thronged with boatmen, dockers and merchants. Today, it's lined with bars and restaurants. And we've stepped ashore to soak up the atmosphere.
Wonderful to see the canal so busy.
They're full of life. It's been wonderfully restored.
Yes.
All we need is a few boats.
Before the final leg of our journey to the cathedral, we need to pop down to the shops.
Bit posher than Clapham Junction.
Yes, a bit.
As I have some husbandly duties to perform.
Well, I know I promised you a present from Milano, didn't I? But
yes.
I don't think an actor's salary quite runs to a new dress at Prada.
Not even if it's tax deductible?
No, I'm afraid not. Although we might manage a hat.
Oh, magic.
Anything you fancy?
That one looks rather dizzy.
All right, let's have a look.
Mutinelli's hat shop is owned by Signor Matteo Mutinelli, a fourth-generation hat fitter.
My grand-grandfather opened it here in 1888.
Yes, that was him?
Yes. Yes. The same family in the same place for 130 years.
Thanks to some marvelous machines, the Mutinellis were pioneers in the science of matching the right hat to the right head.
Extraordinary, what a contraption.
With this machine, you take the perfect shape for your head.
I've got a very big head.
Big head, but no problem. I have a big hat.
How do I look?
Wonderful, we'll bite.
It's not quite that easy, darling.
I'd like to try that one. Something a bit more exotic.
That's good for Ascot. Yes, is that Smith Babb? Mm. Yes. No. Come on, don't be ridiculous. Next. Yes, you're very good in chaps' hats, indeed, yes. I think that's wonderful. Yes.
I'm a dream lady.
You're a dream lady. All right, fine. That's the one, yes.
May we take this one, please?
Oh, thank you. Perfect.
Thank you. Come on, dream lady. We've still got a delivery to make. You still got your bit of marble?
Yes.
Well, it won't be long now before we're at the Duomo, and you can give it back.
Barges carried marble to the cathedral for six centuries. But the last one delivered its load in the late 1930s. That is, until today.
Through here is the Darsena, which is the place where the boats from the different areas used to unload. It was through that blocked-up tunnel that marble was taken through to the Duomo.
For us, this is the closest we can get by boat.
OK, off we get. Ciao, Giuseppe.
Arrivederci, grazie tanto.
Grazie.
And now, our pilgrimage is nearing its final destination.
Magnifico.
Yeah. Started in 1386. And finished in 1965.
Well, some things are worth waiting for.
You say that, yeah.
Designed to fit Milan's entire 15th century population of 40,000, it must have needed countless barges full of marble. And seeing the Duomo's 135 spires, more than any other church in the world.
And its 3,400 statues.
Just amazing, isn't it?
It's astonishing.
We're starting to understand why it took almost 600 years to complete.
How are you, Prune?
Hello.
At the top, we're reunited with director Francesco Canali.
I brought this back for you.
Oh, yes.
In case you might need it for repairs.
Thank you so much, Prune. We always need marble from Candoglia. I shall see the right place to use this.
Good.
Although the blocks they usually use are a little larger, stone on this extremely old structure is constantly being replaced.
How much of the early cathedral is still here?
I would say some 70%.
Oh, right.
Of course, the lowest part are the oldest and still the best conserved. The higher ones, more exposed to wind and rain, need a more intensive restoration.
Yes, of course. Yes.
Director Canali is the latest in a long line of chief engineers stretching back to the Renaissance.
It's a commitment. Everyone who has been involved in the cathedral construction has to respect God and the idea that the cathedral symbolized.
Yes.
Right.
It's the idea of shared purpose, that generations are linked across the centuries by one great endeavor.
Well, the people who built all this certainly left their mark on the world.
Extraordinary to leave something of such incredible beauty.
It's a bit like rehearsing a play, really, isn't it? To be working together on rehearsals for 600 years.
Well, it's lasted a bit longer than some of our runs. It's almost eternal.
Well, that is the idea.
Yes, I suppose so. I suppose so.
Next time, Manchester to the Mersey. I feel quite honored to be on board.
So do I.
As we explore some of the wonders from the golden age of canals.
It won't swing with us on it, will it?
I hope not.
And with family on board, we rediscover why we first fell in love with canals all those years ago.
Family boating.
Right.
Family boating.
And Tim and Prue will be back with all those adventures in 2 weeks' time as we Formula One next Sunday from 6. And we enter the dark world of online witness intimidation as Livy Haydock investigates Stitches for Snitches, dispatches tomorrow night at 8. Next tonight, though, is that really Harry Potter or some kind of sleight of hand? There's a trick or two waiting in the network premiere of Now You See Me 2.